And this weekend, we're starting a brand new series. So we'd like to welcome everyone who's watching us online, watching us on our TV program, or listening on the radio. How about all of you giving them a warm welcome? Thank you all for watching. We appreciate it. And I want to encourage you, if you are ever in our area and you can visit our church, we encourage you to come out and visit. How many here would treat them really well if they came out and visited us? So we encourage them to do that. Our new series is on the subject of faith. And if you've been part of our church through the long haul, which many of you have, we've been teaching on the subject of faith for years. It's been a while since I actually did a series on the subject. We might mention it in series, but we're going to take the next 7 weeks and we're going to talk about the subject of faith. And this weekend, what I'd like to do is just sort of give us something that we can springboard off of for the next 6 weeks. So this is sort of like an introduction to faith, especially for all of you that are new to the church. All of you that have been here for a while, this is sort of a refresher course today in what we're going to talk about. I want to start off talking about computers today, and I don't know how many people in here are familiar with computers. You probably all use them. In fact, let me see your hands. How many here have at least one computer in your home or in your office? Let me see your hands. So, you know, if we would have asked that about 20 years ago, there would have been very few hands that went up, but almost every hand in this place went up that everyone has a computer. About 15 years ago, maybe a little bit longer than that, I was the guy that everyone would talk to about what kind of computer they should buy. My family would call me, different people would ask me, you know, what kind of computer should we, I was like up on all of it. If I was flying somewhere, the thing that I bought at the airport, you know, in their bookstore, I bought magazines on computers and what's the best computer, what's the fastest computer, what's the best operating system, all that kind of stuff. And so I knew a lot about computers. I stopped doing it because we hired people here that do all that, so I'm not going to waste my time. They know better than me, and they're much better than I ever was. But here in our church, we have two different kind of computers in our church. We have a network system, and it supports Windows, and all of our computers, you know, are hooked up to that, and we can all talk to each other because they're all on Windows. But we have several guys in our church that in order to do their job, they have to be on the best computer made, and that's an Apple, that's a Mac computer. They have to be on that in order to do their job properly. So it's interesting because we tried to hook them up to our network when we first started trying to do all of that, and it's just really not good because one operates on a Windows operating system, the other one, of course, is Apple OS system, and it's not compatible. They don't talk to each other. And with that in mind, and most of you might be here and say, I don't understand a thing. Well, think about your phone. If you have an Apple phone, you know that your phone does not communicate as far as technology-wise. It's not going to communicate with, remember the old flip phones that we used to have? Well, those phones are gone pretty much. I mean, if you still have one, God bless you, but you should really upgrade. But the truth of the matter is they don't function on the same kind of operating system. So here's what's interesting about that, and here's why I say all of that. Before you received Christ in your life, you had an operating system that you operated in. You might not know it, but you did. Once you received Christ, God downloaded on the inside of you a new operating system. And so I think all of you know this, but just because I'm gonna think there's some people here that might not, I want you to hear this. There are some people in this room that you understand that the new operating system you have is not compatible with the old one you used to have, and they don't function together properly. Most of you know that. But there are some people sitting here today that you're still operating under the old system that many of us operated on for years. And that old operating system is geared by one thing. It runs on one system, and that system is fear. The operating system that all of us used to operate under before we received Christ, it's a system of fear. Everything is motivated by fear. The new system that God downloaded in you, it's called the kingdom of God. You know there's the kingdom of this world. Now you have this kingdom of God that's been downloaded in you. This new kingdom that's been downloaded on the inside of you is a faith operating system. Your new system on the inside operates by faith. So I know there are a lot of new people in our church, and I think this is so vital for you to understand. If you're sitting here today and this is what you're thinking, well, I've come from the Baptist faith. And if you're sitting here thinking, you know, I came from the Catholic faith. I came from the Presbyterian faith. That's my background. That's my faith. That's absolutely not what I'm talking about. And that has nothing to do with when God talks about faith in his word, that has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. That's, you know, that's the religion you came out of. That's the religion you were. But when we came to Christ, he got rid of religion. We came to Jesus. There is no religion, right? And so what Jesus came, he said this. His disciples came to him and said, Lord, they obviously saw that faith was important. They came to Jesus and they said, Lord, increase our faith. And Jesus never said this, because I know some of you do this. You do it with a good heart. You don't know any better. We all learn, right? Jesus never said this. Pray for more faith and you'll get some more. You cannot find one scripture in the New Testament, nor Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, which is all what we consider New Testament. You cannot find one scripture where Jesus said this, pray for more faith and I'll give you more. Not a scripture in the Bible. So here's my heart on this, and here's where I'm coming from in this series. I want you to know how to get more faith, because faith is how this new kingdom that you live in operates. So this kingdom you operate in right now, it never works like this. God, I just wish you would do something. God, I'm wishing, I'm hoping, and I'm praying. I'm just hoping you do something. Nothing ever works that way. This kingdom we live in now operates or is governed by faith. And if you don't know anything about faith, you're in a great place. We're going to give you 7-week shot of faith where I believe you'll understand it better. You'll come out of this knowing more about faith and knowing more about how it operates. So if someone came to me and they said, hey, pastor, what do you think, once you're saved, once you ask Jesus into your heart, what do you think the 3 most important things are? Here's what I would tell them. Here's what I would tell you. Number one, I believe after salvation, your relationship with the Holy Spirit is the number one thing that you should know about. Holy Spirit, right? Everyone agree? You might disagree, but it's all right. I'm preaching, so I get to say whatever I want, right? Number two, I believe the second most important thing is you understanding about grace. Because grace is everything that God did for you in Christ. You better understand grace, right? And number three, and it's not third in ranking per se, number three is the subject of faith. Because listen to how this works. Faith receives everything. So if you want to receive what God did for you, you're going to need to have faith and understand how to receive what God did for you. In fact, if you're taking notes, you should write this down. Faith is a receiver. Grace is a giver. God is grace. He did all that. He gave you faith, and he asked you to do some things with it, like exercise it and use it. Let me ask you a question. Don't raise your hand on this. We don't want to embarrass anyone. But how many of you at the beginning of this year did what you do every year and you thought, you know what, I'm going to join a gym. I'm going to start working out. And how many of you are card members right now of a gym that's in your pocket right now, and you're a card member and you haven't gone now for 4 months? I know it's a few of you. I know there are people here that's what you do every year. You're like, I joined a gym. And I've had people come to me before and they'll say, pastor, you know, I hear you preaching, man. I do all that stuff that you do. You know, I got a gym membership and I work out and I eat healthy and I do all that kind of stuff. But how many know that you can tell when someone's doing that and when someone's not? And we have a bunch of people like that about the Bible. There's a bunch of people that say, I know all the scriptures. In fact, if you talk to them, they'll say, I know that. There are a bunch of people that say, I know all those scriptures about faith. But listen, faith and scriptures don't do you any good unless you do something with them. So if you're just gonna read them and say, that's nice, but they don't motivate you, move you, or change you, then they're just scriptures. Anybody can read them. You don't even need to know Jesus to read them. But once you know Jesus, these scriptures should move you to do something. So I want to say this before we go to any scriptures and talk about this. Faith is not for you to just be consuming it on yourself. Your faith and your faith growing is so you can help other people. Come on, you gotta understand this. We gotta get out of the consumer mentality of, I just want more faith. Because listen, I've been around this for a long time. I went to faith seminars year after year, hearing people preach about faith, but I found this out. It doesn't do me a bit of good to hear all of that teaching if I don't do anything with it and I don't help others with the faith I say that I have. It's all about helping other people. sort of like this. Last night after I got done preaching and everyone hearing the message that I preached on, a young lady came up after church and said, I want two things. Can you help me with two things? She said, I would like to receive Jesus Christ as my Savior. I don't know what that means, but I want it. And number two, I've just been diagnosed with a tumor in my brain. Can you pray for me? I heard your church believes God still heals. Well, we want to be able, right? We don't want to look at a person like that and say, well, I have all this faith and I believe God's such a big and great God. I believe this for me and my family, but I'm sorry, I can't help you. We want great faith and our faith increasing in God so that we can help other people. This is all about helping others. So if you're taking notes, I'm gonna have you just jot three things down real quickly. If you're taking notes and you know it, taking notes causes you to remember it better, so we encourage you to do that. There are three kinds of faith that the Bible talks about. We're only gonna talk about one of them, but I'll give you all three real quickly. Number one is salvation faith. Of course, most importantly, because if we don't get saved, you know, you can't really understand anything else in the Bible. So salvation faith works like this. Someone hears the gospel, the good news. You see this happen every weekend. Last night we saw it happen in church. The amount of people that came down here and received Christ last night was just amazing on a Saturday night. So we see it on Easter weekend, Christmas weekend, where crowds of people come to receive Christ. What did they do? They heard the gospel. Faith was put in their heart, and that comes from hearing the gospel, and they responded. Faith always demands a response, so they respond, and they come and receive Jesus. We love that, right? That's called salvation faith. Second kind of faith is just general Bible faith. Jesus said this. Jesus said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, that means small. He said, you could say to the mountain and it would move. So Jesus said, listen, you don't need great faith. Too many people are trying to get great faith. He said, you just need faith and it will move a mountain. How many are thankful that you can have faith in God? And he said, that kind of faith will move a mountain. So this kind of faith, if you want to know a little bit more about it, Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 and 2 lists six basic doctrines in the church. And in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 and 2, it says, faith towards God is one of the six basic doctrines. Not faith in Jesus. Faith towards or in God. In other words, we have faith in God. We believe God can still do the things he said in his word. We have faith that God can move in our marriages. We have faith that God can move in our children's lives. We have faith that God can move in our bodies. We have faith for that because faith comes from God's word. And if God's word puts faith in your heart, you can believe whatever he says. And so we'll talk more about that. So that's simple Bible faith. That's the one we're gonna concentrate on. And then the third one, which most people know about but not really heard much teaching about, we've done teaching on it over the years here at the church, is real simple. It's called the gift of faith. And it's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, one of the nine gifts of the Spirit. We're not talking about that today. But the gift of faith is, it's really called special faith. And people have thought, well, I wish I had that. But all of us have general Bible faith. And Jesus said that kind of faith will move a mountain. So instead of trying to get the special faith that most people only will have once in a while operate in their life, let's just go after the kind of faith that Jesus said we could have. And that's just general Bible faith. Now, I wanna get to some scriptures, so just hold on. But I have some stuff. I'm just sharing some stuff out of my heart that I think is important. We have a whole new generation of people that have raised up over the last 10 or 15 years in our churches. And grace has been an important teaching that all of us have heard. But what happened is, and this has happened in many churches, there's a fight against faith and grace. It's like they're in opposition against each other. You're either a faith church or a grace church. And I have news for you. We're both of those. We're not one or the other, right? We believe God still does good things for people. We still believe that God is a God of faith, but he also did everything for us in Christ. But here's the deal. The reason why a lot of the people that are raising up that are new in the church don't have anything that we all had, you know, as we were being raised, we watched God heal our children. We watched God heal our bodies. We watched God do all kind of crazy stuff that most people would be like, you gotta be kidding. God did that kind of stuff. We watched him do that because we walked by faith. And when all that was happening, man, God was doing some great things. The new generation thinks this. Grace is everything God did for you in Christ. So, well, I don't have to do anything. No, it's everything God did, but you can't have any of it unless you receive it by faith. Faith is not works. Faith is you working the word. And so some people have gotten confused with it and they think, well, I just live in grace and everything is grace. Well, grace is awesome. You hear me teach on it all the time. But grace is what God did for you in Christ. Faith receives it. Faith says it's mine. I need that in my life. I want that in my life. And I'm going to take that in my life. Faith takes what God did in grace and says, I'm going to have that in my life. So it's pretty simple. We'll talk more about that in the weeks to come. So today, I want to talk to you about this. In Romans, if you want to turn there, you can. If not, it will just be up on the screen. This is found in Romans chapter 5. And it's an interesting verse of scripture, Romans chapter 5, 1 and 2. It says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 2, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace. I just want everyone to read it out loud. Verse 2, starting right at the beginning. Read it out loud. Through whom also we have access by faith into this grace. In other words, here's what he's simply saying. He's saying faith gives you access to everything God did for you in Christ. How are you going to get everything that God did? You know, back years ago, I was teaching on grace. This is, I'll tell you how long ago it was. It's when we were in the upstairs building on Portage Street back years and years ago. So we're talking about our church will be, I think, 27 years old this year. So probably 26 years ago, I was teaching on grace. And I sort of compared it like this. This is the illustration that God gave me. Grace is like a pie. And you know how when you have a pie and you cut it into all the sections so you can get a piece out for every person, right? You know how that works? Y'all know how pie works? All right. Apple pie, you know, so you're cutting it and you got them all these slices ready to go. Grace is this thing that God did for you. You don't have anything to do with it. It's like an apple pie that someone just gives you. And grace has all these slices of everything that God did for you. In those slices is healing. In those slices is God financially blessing you. Even though you might be here and say, well, I don't believe in that prosperity stuff. It doesn't matter. God does. So you can go ahead and not believe in it, but God does actually believe in it. All the way from old, all the way to new, God always believed in blessing his children. It's not something that we go after only and say, all I want is money, but God wants you blessed. It's part of grace. Part of grace is you having the Holy Spirit, called the baptism of the Holy Spirit in your life. They're all slices in grace. You don't get any of them unless you reach out and take it. Faith is you reaching out and taking what God did for you. So grace has all this stuff. It's great. Great to hear about. Makes you feel really good. But I want it in my life. I don't want to just hear about it. Faith says this is how you take it. So here's some scriptures, and I think they'll put these up on the screen. There's just multiple scriptures that say this. First of all, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, it says we walk by faith and not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5, 7, we walk by faith and not by sight. Then you'll notice this, there's a bunch of them. Romans 1, 17, Galatians 3, 11, Hebrews 10, 38, Habakkuk 2, 4 says the just shall live by faith. So listen to this real carefully. This is a walk of faith that all of us are in. Even if you never knew it, it is. And the Bible says those who've been made right with God, they live by faith. So this is supposed to be a faith walk. Well, listen, we all came out of a sight life. Before you receive Jesus, you live by your five senses. Once you receive Jesus, there's a new sense called the sixth sense, and it is living by faith. And when you walk by faith, there are times your eyes are going to say something different than what God said. When you walk by faith, there's times your ears are going to say something different than what God said. When you walk by faith, there are times your body's going to feel stuff different than what God said about you. It doesn't mean you're a bad person. It doesn't mean you're a weak person. It doesn't mean anything wrong at all with you just because an attack comes. All it means is I need to get over into faith. And I need to believe what God said over what my body says. I need to believe what God says over what my eyes are seeing. I need to believe what God says over what my ears are hearing. I have to start believing God. So we walk by faith in what? Not by sight. We don't walk by our five senses. Listen, it doesn't mean you ignore symptoms. It doesn't mean you ignore stuff that is going on. Instead, you face it and say, I'm going to apply God's word to it. I'm not going to ignore it. I know many, many, many people who have ignored symptoms in their body. And when they went to the doctors told them, if you would have just came earlier And so they're sort of behind the curve. It's like, man, now that this all has to happen. And I know we want a miracle and I know we want healing, but don't ignore symptoms in your body. If they're there, deal with them. Start speaking God's word to them, but just don't ignore them and act like they're not there. Speak the word of God to them. Are you all with me? And so here's what I want to do. I want you to all turn with me. If you have a Bible, if you have a phone, an iPad or whatever other device you have, I don't know the names of other ones, so whatever they are, if you have something you can look on right now, would you turn with me to Hebrews chapter 11? I want you to see these scriptures. I know we'll have them on the screen also, but go there with me to Hebrews chapter 11. And let's let the word of God define what faith is. Hebrews chapter 11. And we're going to read verse 1. We know it's a great faith chapter. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. It says this, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I can remember back the first time I ever heard that scripture. I absolutely have no idea what it was talking about when I heard it. I was like, huh, interesting. That's confusing to me. I don't know. I mean, maybe you all are more spiritual than me. When I read that, it's like, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. It just doesn't click. But then I started reading it out of other translations. And listen to what it says. This is the Phillips translation. It says, now faith means putting our full confidence in things we hope for. It means being certain of things we cannot see. Well, how many here have ever hoped for something before? Let me see your hands. Let me tell you what hope is not. Hope is not what America, you know, uses in their language about hope. Like, you know, you say this sometimes. Man, I hope so. That's not what the Bible definition of hope is. The Bible definition of the word hope is a confident expectation, something you're expecting. So when you see the word hope, it's different than what we know in America. What we know in America is someone asks you a question, you say, well, I hope so. Well, you're not saying I have a confident expectation that that's going to happen. That's not our definition in our mind. We're just thinking, I don't know, it might happen, it might not. I hope so. That's not what God's saying. So if you have this idea, I hope someday I'll be healed. I hope so. I don't know. God might kill me. He might heal me. I don't know which one it's going to be. I hope he heals me. You'll never get healed. You'll never experience what God really wants for your life if we always have hope out in front instead of faith as the center of our lives. And we're not trying to cut hope down. You'll see next week, we're going to actually talk a little bit more about hope, and you don't want to miss what we're going to be talking about it. Hope is one of the most important things in our lives. In fact, today when you came into church, if you're here and you're a person in church today and you have no hope at all, you know what our heart's desire is? To put hope in you. That it can be better than it is right now. If you have a marriage that's broken, that God can heal your marriage. If you have children that have gone off and done things that you're like, oh gosh, we believe that we can put hope in your heart, that God can change that. If you need a job, we can put hope in your heart, that God's bigger than you just walking around not having a job and he can get you a job. We want to put hope in your heart. So hope is vital. We don't dislike hope. We just need to make sure it has the proper place in our lives. So he says, listen, hope, and I like this translation out of all of them, and you can just listen to it or read on the screen. It's called the Expanded Bible Translation. Faith means this, being sure, or the assurance, or the tangible reality, or the sure foundation. In other words, faith gives you a sure foundation on what you're going to believe, of things we hope for, and knowing that something is real, even if we do not see it. The conviction, assurance, evidence about things not seen. So I know you probably don't understand this completely, but do you know this, right? Everything today that you see, God made from a world or a place that was unseen. You understand that? I mean, so everything you see today, right here, right now, everything you see, God made from a realm called the unseen realm, and he brought all that stuff into this realm. I know it's mind-boggling. I know you're like, I don't understand that, but that's how faith works. Faith takes something right now that's not seen and brings it into this realm that is seen. So in other words, it works like this. Romans chapter 4, verse 17 and 18, talking about Abraham, it says, so Abraham called those things which be not as though they were. God did it first. Then, of course, Abraham continued on with the same principle. He called those things which be not as though they were. You say, what does that mean? Well, when Abraham had no children, God came and changed his name from Abram to Abraham. He had his name changed to Father of Many Nations when he had no kids. He had no children at all. And God said, I'm going to call you the Father of Many Nations. So you know what that means? There are gonna be times where you're gonna have to say things, speak things, and pray things that right now it doesn't look that way. But you're gonna pray God's word, and you're gonna agree with God's word. So that means it's gonna make you do something that it looks crazy. I mean, when the world looks in on this, they think we're crazy. But remember, we have a new operating system, so it's different than theirs. You know, the world is motivated by fear. We're not motivated by the same thing. And when I say fear, you know, fear looks different in every way. It's motivated by doubt. Fear has doubt in it. So you know this, right? This is coming up just in fall here. We're gonna hear this. This is what we're gonna hear in fall. You need to go out and you need to buy everything you can to stop your nose from getting all clogged up, because it's coming. Fall is coming. And you know that happens, right? I mean, it happens to all of us. We see it. And then how many here have ever walked into like Target or Walmart and whatever commercial that was, it's right there on display. And your mind thinks, you know what, I better grab it now because it's gonna happen. So it's on sale. I might as well get it because I'm gonna need it. They motivate you by fear. It's not just they're motivating you by what is. They're motivating you, telling you, this is what's gonna happen to you. And you should know that you should buy this product. They do it all the time. You're gonna have nose stuffed up. You're gonna have a cough. Buy it all now. Come on, some of you are looking saying, yep, I know exactly. I've seen it. I've seen it happen in my own life. God, on the other hand, says this. You can prepare your life by faith and start saying, God, every year I've had sinus problems, but I'm gonna trust you this year that you're gonna move in my body, whatever you have to do to fix it, and my body's not gonna have that sinus deal any longer. God can do that. You might say, well, that's something small. I'll let this stuff, you know, that I squirt up there, I'll let it handle it. God can handle the big things. But God likes handling the little things. So, interesting enough, it goes on in verse 2 in Hebrews chapter 11, because I want to get this all out. Verse 2 says this, Hebrews chapter 11, in verse 2, it says, for by faith, that's what it's referring to, the elders obtained a good testimony or a good report. So, here's what God's looking at. God's looking at all of us taking faith and getting a good report when we get to heaven. You might say, what does that mean? Well, all of us know what report cards are, right? Everyone know what, remember report cards? How many remember in school, the last thing they would ever let you do is have an open book test? I tried to have some on my own, but they never worked. So they never would allow you to have an open book test, right? But God comes along and says, hey, you're gonna get tests in this world, but I want you to have an open book while they're going on. So every test that you're going through, everything that you face in life, it's an open book test. You're allowed to go and look. You're allowed to cheat. You're allowed to go in the back and say, I gotta find this one place where that scripture is. You're allowed to go in it. This isn't high school. This isn't college. It's open book test every single day. This is why so many people fell in their walk with God and in their Christian life is because they don't ever open the book. If we would just start opening it and finding the places that God promised us something, then God will do that in our lives. And so he says, man, they all obtained a good report. And then I want you to skip down just real quickly to verse 3. Watch what it says. By faith, we understand the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. We already talked about that. The Names of God Bible says it this way. Faith convinces us that God created the world through his word. This means what can be seen was made by something that could not be seen. In other words, man, just what we talked about, God made everything you see today out of a realm that you can't see it at all. He's still doing the same thing today. But then verse 6 is what I want, and then we're gonna close this up. Verse 6, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. I want you to just read that first part with me, right up on the screen, ready? But without faith, it's impossible to please him. Well, faith isn't hard, so we need to understand. Watch what he says. For he who comes to God must believe that he is and a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Let me read it out of another translation. This is Philip's translation. It says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. The man who approaches God must have faith in two things. First, God exists. And second, that it's worth a man's while to try to find God or seek him, in other words. I like this translation. This is the Good News translation. It says, no one can please God without faith. Isn't that true? Let's read it out loud. I think you should hear this. Hear yourself saying it. Ready? No one can please God without faith. For whoever comes to God must have faith that he exists and rewards those who seek him. So I don't know how much you've heard about faith in the past. I don't know how much you know about faith because we're all at different levels with this, but we can't please God without it. So, you know, we've heard people on the opposite side say, you know, enough said about faith. We don't need anything to hear about this stuff about faith. But God says you can't please him without it. So that tells me this. You should be a person who says, I'm going to jump in and find out as much as I can about faith for my life and how to live a life of faith. So here's what we're going to do. If I could have you leave with anything today, I started thinking about this a few weeks ago when I knew I was teaching this first weekend. And I thought, what could I teach on that I would believe would be most beneficial before you walk out this door? And so I'm gonna break it down to the three most important things you need to know about faith before you walk out this door. And it's gonna be quick, so don't be like, oh God, we got three more points. I'll just do them real quickly. I believe these are the three things that every person who is in this room, who's watching us, should know about the subject of faith. Number one, you should know what faith is. And there's a definition if you wanna write it down. What is faith? Faith is what you believe, it's what you're convinced of, and it's what you're convicted of, and you could add on to it, it's what you're persuaded of. But they'll leave that up on the screen for a minute so you can write it down. So here's simply what faith is. Faith is what you're convinced about. It's pretty simple. So are you convinced that God heals? Then you have faith. Are you convinced that God exists like we just read in the scripture? Then you have faith. Are you convinced that God rewards those who diligently seek him? Then you have faith. You know all the preachers that get up and say, God doesn't reward anyone if they seek him. You know there's preachers like that, right? They'll say, God doesn't do any of that stuff. God doesn't reward you that's even a wrong attitude. But God says in verse 6 that we just read, he rewards them that diligently seek him. He said, if you do that and you believe that, you're convinced of that, you have faith. I wanna ask a simple question before we move on to point number two. How many here believe that God exists today? Just raise your hand. How many believe? Some of you might not. It's fine if you don't. If you don't raise your hand, you're like, oh, I don't know if I believe that or not. It's all right. We're glad you're here. You're seeking God and we're cool with that. But most of the hands went up in this place. You believe that God exists. Do you know that means you have faith? According to what we just read in the scripture, the only other thing you need to have is, I believe if I seek him, he rewards me. That's what it said. If you can believe those two things, you have faith. Let's get convinced, persuaded that what God said in his word is true and we don't need a preacher to mess it up. We don't need a preacher telling us, you know, that's really not true. If you seek God and think he's gonna reward you for something, he's really not gonna do that. Because here's what the Greek language says of that verse we read. It says, if you seek God, payday is coming. Now he's not talking about money in this verse. He's talking about whatever you're seeking him for, payday's coming. You all know what that means, right? I mean, everybody likes payday. So you know if I seek God, God's got a payday that will come. God will reward you. God will bless you. He has a payday that will come every single time. I like that. So if you're here and you say, man, I don't believe like that, Pastor, then you have to get in the Bible and start allowing the Bible to convince you differently. Just because you believe different doesn't mean the Bible's not true. Second thing about faith that you need to know that I want you to write down is you need to know how faith comes, right? I mean, this is pretty simple. How does faith come? Everybody in the room that's been a Christian for more than a year probably knows this. Romans 10:17 says, now faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word. So I just want to take a minute. I want you to understand this. The only way faith comes is by the word. Let me say this without condemning. I'm not saying this. I watch TV. I'm sure many of you watch TV. I'm not saying it for this reason. Faith doesn't come watching Fox News. Faith doesn't come watching your favorite sitcom. Right? Faith doesn't come that way. Faith comes how? By hearing the word. That's how faith comes. Faith doesn't come any other way. So faith, this really isn't faith, but I'm gonna just say it like this. Faith in the opposite comes though, listening to things you shouldn't. See, if you listen long enough to the doom and gloom that's out there, you'll do like many Christians have done, and there might be some in this room, I'm not trying to embarrass you or anything, but you'll go buy all your bottled water and stick it in your basement because the end is coming. God promised us in his word in the New Testament, in the epistles, which are letters written to the church, he promised us that when the last days come and the end of days comes, he'll protect us, he'll guard us, he'll keep us. I'm not buying water so that I got my water stocked up, I got all this food in the basement stocked up, because man, the end is coming. That's fear motivated. And I know there are preachers, I've seen them on, I watch them sometimes just to get a laugh, you know, that they're on preaching, telling you, you need to buy this water thing that I'm selling. You understand what they're doing, right? They're selling stuff, but you bought it. I got my water thing, and when all the water gets polluted, I got this thing that will, you can buy it if you want. No, God, it's fine, but I'm just telling you, God's bigger than that, and God promised us he'll take care of us. And there are churches all over the world putting people in fear. But here's the problem why they're putting people in fear. Because no one's bold enough to stand up and say, the church won't even be here during that time. According to the Bible, we get taken out. So I'm not gonna be here. If you wanna stay here, you say, well, I wanna go with the third load or whatever. Fine, you can stay here, but I'm not gonna stay here. The Bible calls it the catching away. There's no such word as rapture in the Bible. The Bible calls it the catching away, and I'm gonna be caught away. I'm not gonna be here. I don't wanna go through the tribulation. People say, well, we're in the tribulation now. This is the beginning. Didn't start yet. The Bible calls it the birth pains. We're here now, but we're getting taken out. According to scripture, we don't have to go through any of this stuff. Now, you might be here and say, I disagree. I heard a preacher different. That's fine. You believe what you wanna believe. I'm going up and out. That's what I believe, right? You can believe whatever you want. So how does faith come? Every time you open your Bible and you read your Bible, faith comes. Every time you're in church and someone's preaching out of the Bible, faith comes. So you know, when you need faith for your marriage, for it to be better, you gotta go to scriptures that really deal with that, right? I mean, all scriptures can help you and all scriptures can build your faith. I'm not saying that, but man, if I'm having marriage problems, let me go to Ephesians chapter 5 and read some scriptures that will help me with my marriage. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. I'm gonna read these places because they will help me with my marriage. Faith comes how? And fear comes how? By hearing. So if I keep on hearing things that fill me with fear, my kids will never go to school. I'm afraid something bad might happen there. You know, so if I keep on hearing, you know, about things that are happening and bad things, you know, I mean, I won't ever get on an airplane because, man, they can crash. So you won't ever do anything. And then, of course, we have within our churches the conspiracy theory people. And they don't realize this is not even the world you're living in is not your world. You're just living here. It doesn't matter. We don't care what conspiracy's going on out there. We're from another planet. We're from another world. But if you get filled with all the garbage that you keep on listening to, it puts you in this frame of mind. Oh man, there's something going on. Man, that Obama, there's something going on. Hey, there's been something going on since Washington. And the church needs to rise up and say, yeah, there's a bunch of stuff going on, but there's actually a better way, and God can save you from all this junk that's going on down here. Instead of blaming it on Obama or blaming it on Reagan or whoever it was you blamed whatever on, let's just not do that and look at it and say, we serve a God that said he'll take care of us no matter what is going on. But see, if you're not in a church that ever says that and all you ever hear about, it's bad. It's gonna get worse. Doom and gloom's gonna come. Oh my gosh, in September this year, bad is going to happen and everything's gonna, well good, if something in September bad is gonna happen, you know what it's gonna be? The church is out of here. Because that's the worst thing that could ever happen. The church leaves, and then God starts doing what he said he would do during the 7-year tribulation. So the second thing is this. Faith comes by hearing the word. Faith does not come by hearing what USA Today says or what CNN says. It comes by the word. But third and most importantly, listen to this. You need to know how to release faith. Because here's the deal. If I know about faith, it's sort of like the guy that says, I have the gym membership. I have it in my pocket. I'm a card-carrying member of such and such a gym. But if you never go there, it doesn't do you any good. So if you know all this stuff about faith, like I know what faith is, I know how faith comes, but you don't know how to release it in the situations that you're going through, it doesn't benefit you. Faith will never benefit you until you release it into situations. I'll just quote you one scripture. Jesus said this, you all know it. Mark chapter 11, verse 23, Jesus said, whoever will say to the mountain, be removed, be thou cast into the sea, you do not doubt in your heart, believe what you said, you'll have whatever you say. Amen. Isn't that last part crazy? Now, I know some of you are sitting here, you're one of those preachers that believe you can have what you say. I believe what Jesus said. Jesus said, you could say to the mountain, be removed, be thou cast into the sea, don't doubt in your heart, believe what you said, and you will have whatever you said. Now listen, I know you're here and you're like, I don't believe that. Listen, this is all you have to do. Do a checkup. Right now, today, you have everything you've been saying over the last 10 years, you have it today. Your experience in a life of everything you said yesterday, today, who you are today, what you have today, it's all from what I said yesterday. You had what you said yesterday, today. You might be here and say, man, Pastor, I don't agree. I don't believe you can have what you say. Everyone in this room is experiencing it, either good or bad, right here now today, because things you said, you are experiencing them now. So I want you to just check this quote out. This is a quote from a friend of mine. I heard him say it just recently in a seminar that he was doing by the name of Keith Moore. He'll be coming here in fall here in this church. And he said this, when it comes to faith, you cannot leave up to God what he left up to you. And then he went on and said this, Jesus cannot receive for you what God has already done. I'm gonna say it one more time. You cannot leave up to God what he left up to you. God left up to you faith in believing him. And Jesus cannot receive for you what God has already done for you. In other words, guys, God can't do for you what he wants you to do. So in other words, listen, God can't save a sinner. The sinner has to hear, the person who doesn't know God, they have to hear the good news and they have to respond. They have to do something. As a Christian, you have to hear the word of God and you have to do something. You want your marriage to change? You have to do something. You want your kids to change? You have to do something. I'm gonna close with this quick story and we'll let you go. Listen to this. In the Gospels, there are 19 individual cases of healing found. I don't know if you know that or not. I'm talking about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We know Matthew, Mark, and Luke are the synoptic Gospels. Most of the stories are the same in them. John's a little bit different. But in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there are 19 individual cases of healing. That does not include when the Bible says the multitudes were healed. We don't know how many that was, and so we know there was many more. John says this at the end of his gospel. John says, if you wrote down everything that Jesus did, there were not books enough to hold them. So Jesus did so much stuff, there's not even enough books to hold it. That's a lot of stuff. But I'm just talking about 19 individual cases in your Bible, in the New Testament, individuals who were healed by Jesus. Out of those 19, 10 of them, Jesus turned to them and said this, your faith made you whole. Three other ones, he inferred it. He didn't say it that way. He inferred that their faith made them whole. So out of 19, 13 of them were people that Jesus looked at, turned and said to them, your faith made you whole. Your faith healed you. Because of your faith, you have this done. Now, that sounds like, oh God, all the responsibility's on me. But listen, guys, faith isn't hard. Faith is just what you believe. So if you can just start simply believing that Jesus will do what he said in his word, it makes it pretty easy. I believe he'll do what he said in his word. Faith believes what God said in his word he will do. So today, what we're gonna do is give you an assignment. And I think it's important, especially when you're teaching on faith, that you don't just sit here and say, just give me more about that, Pastor. I'm trying to get my faith built up. Wait a minute, Jesus said small faith can move big mountains. We're not here to try to get your faith built up real high. We're just trying to get you to do something with the faith you have. It automatically build up as you use it and you feed it. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to write this down. If you're taking notes, this is your assignment for this week. I want to simply put it this way. We're gonna feed our faith on God's word this week. So here's how we're gonna do it. Because faith comes by hearing, right? So here's what we're gonna do. I want to ask you a favor, starting tomorrow, that you will read one chapter out of your Bible in the New Testament, one chapter, to feed your faith every single day. That by next week when we show up here, all of us would have had fed our faith every day from today, Monday all the way till Saturday, then Sunday. We feed our faith once a day by what? Reading one chapter. If you're like, I don't know what chapter to read, I'm talking about the New Testament, not the old. Don't go to Leviticus. You're like, I was trying to read Leviticus, man. It didn't do anything, but it messed me all up. Don't read it. Don't read it until you understand the New Testament. So I'm talking about reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. I'm talking about reading the epistles, which is Romans, Galatians, Ephesians, you know, those books. Read them. If you're like, I just want short chapters, go to 1 John. All right? Go to 1 John, not Gospel of John. Go to 1 John and just read 1 John, you know, chapter 1, 2, 3. There's 5 chapters. And then read 2 John. It's 1 chapter. And then read 3 John. It's 1 chapter. You'll be done. It's real easy. They're small chapters. And they're all about love, so that would be really good for you to feed your faith on that this week. Here's all I'm trying to do. I'm trying to help you that you become a person who literally feeds themselves on the Word instead of just saying, I get it when I go to church. I'm going to actually do it when I go home. I'm going to feed my faith. Why? So when I go to work, I can help Joe at work. So that when I go through the mall and I see Tom, I can help Tom. So that when I go to the grocery store and I see Susie over there, I can help her if she needs help. Instead of I'm just consuming it for myself, I'm consuming it so it will come out of me to help other people.